democracy who made possible the emergence of Nehru's rivals. This is the beauty of parliamentary democracy. Vajpayee was a critic of Nehru. Vajpayee was an ideological opponent of Nehru, was given a stage and a platform by Nehru. Our founders dreamt big. They had the audacity of hope. At independence, we had 80% incidence of poverty, we were 12% literate. But we, yes we, poor, not literate, we would be a constitutional parliamentary democracy. What a dream, sir, what a hope. Our founders taught us that for this end, we need to inculcate the virtue of reason. Reason and rationality. When leaders propagate irrationality, when they propagate magical thinking, when they propagate superstition, when they claim to be non-biological beings, they put citizens back to a place where citizens are not able to think, not able to reason. We recall the words of Rabindranath Tagore, "Let my country be one where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way in the dreary desert sands of dead habit." What did B.R. Ambedkar teach us, sir? B.R. Ambedkar said, our political democracy will not last if at its base there is no social democracy. We cannot have political democracy without social democracy, without liberty, without equality, without fraternity in society. We will not be able to sustain our political democracy. Sir, I've been a journalist for 30 years, crisscrossing India, writing reports and writing articles. I was fiercely non-aligned and independent. Today, I'm fiercely aligned. And paradoxically, I am, by being fiercely aligned to the right values, to the values of constitutional norms, to the values of protecting democracy, I feel I can speak the truth. Journalism once had a golden age. Fearless doyens of the free press asked fearless questions of the powerful. Look at the state of the media today. Look at the mainstream newspapers. Look at the television channels. There is one ideology that has a ferocious stranglehold. There is one school of thought that is dominant. A hidden hand is guiding the camera. A not so hidden hand is guiding the journalistic pen. What is happening to the media? is that it has been captured. The media has been captured. Most of the legacy media cannot ask questions of the government anymore. But without asking questions, how can democracy breathe? Without telling truth to power, if journalists cannot tell truth to power, how can democracy get oxygen? Legacy media is getting suffocated in an airless, oxygenless jail. And when media is in jail, how can democracy survive? That is why I have chosen to speak today in response to the Honourable President's address on what I call the democracy deficit. I humbly thank the Honourable President of India for her address. In the address, the respected President said in Para 17, the basic spirit of democracy has been greatly undermined. But undermined by who? In Para 28, the Honourable President referenced the emergency of 1975. But sir, we are not in 1975. We are in 2024. How long are we going to look in the rearview mirror? How long are we going to use the sins of the past? How long are we going to use the sins of the past to condemn the present? Those who are obsessed with the emergency of 1975, if they want to oppose the emergency, why don't they bolster democracy? Why are they imprisoned in an emergency mindset? Why are they imprisoned in an emergency mindset? Why don't they set free the police as per the 2006 Supreme Court judgment? Why don't they uphold the federal principle? Why don't they make India safer for dissent? Why don't they allow the opposition a voice? Why don't they stop having a stranglehold on the democratic institutions? That is the way to oppose the emergency. But what is the point of always opposing the emergency, talking about 1975, but then doing the same thing as 1975, implementing 1975, imitating 1975? Those who are constantly talking about 1975 are victims of an emergency mindset, which is why we have a democracy deficit today, sir. Here are 15 examples today of India's democracy deficit. When the government shows no visible empathy to the suffering, we have a democracy deficit. When instruments of state are used for partisan ends, we have a democracy deficit. When citizenship is defined by religion, we have a democracy deficit. When the party system is attacked, we have a democracy deficit. When there are attempts made to delegitimize the opposition, we have a democracy deficit. When the free press is crushed, we have a democracy deficit. When hate speech is normalized, we have a democracy deficit. When lynch mobs are not given exemplary punishment, we have a democracy deficit. When official speeches do not mention ever by one word the name of a state which has witnessed civil war for over a year, when that name of that state is not mentioned, when Manipur is not mentioned, we have a democracy deficit. When those in power are not accountable, we have a democracy deficit. When individuals believe they are bigger than institutions, we have a democracy deficit. When citizens are not told the truth, we have a democracy deficit. When the federal principle is buried, we have the democracy deficit. When we don't celebrate religious pluralism as India's greatest strength, we have a democracy deficit. When protest is criminalized, we have a democracy deficit. A quick expansion on all of these. Sir, the principle of empathy. To quote Shakespeare, the quality of mercy is not strained. Drop it like the gentle rain from heaven. In the same way, sir, the quality of empathy. Where is empathy? Empathy is a principle of good governance. 24 lakh students sat for the national eligibility and entrance test. A desperate child takes an examination, finds that the paper has leaked, loses that examination, goes on the street to protest, and the education minister says this is a motivated protest. That didn't happen. Where is empathy, sir? So my son is a doctor. I've seen the hard work, the Herculean effort, students pushing themselves to the brink to prepare for these examinations. Where is empathy for these students who are on the street, desperate? 26 students in 2023 took their own lives in 2023 in Kota. 70 papers have leaked in 7 years. This is the nature of the anguish facing the students today. There's a democracy deficit when the instruments of state are used for partisan purposes. When the enforcement agencies become a washing machine, one side always guilty, other side always innocent. The moment you switch sides, you're deemed innocent. Among politicians, 95% cases of the enforcement agencies are against opposition politicians. Since 2014, 25 opposition leaders facing probes have crossed over to the Bharatiya Janata Party. 23 of them have got clean chits. There's a democracy deficit when citizenship is linked to religion. How can religious identity be the basis of citizenship? This is a principle our founders would have opposed with all their might. 19 lakh excluded in Assam, sir, majority of them Hindus. 40 lakh still living under the threat of the CAA and the NRC. Lakhs of people worried that an unconstitutional law is taking away their lives, taking away their liberties, taking away their homes, taking away their universe because of an unconstitutional law imposed from above. There's a democracy deficit when the party system is attacked. With allurements and inducements, parties are broken, governments are toppled, administrations are brought down. Nine governments in 9 years. There's a democracy deficit when attempts are made to delegitimize the opposition. You don't just want to win, you want to delegitimize the opposition completely. Khan Market Gang, Tukre Tukre Gang, Latians Gang. Why this name calling of the opposition, sir? The opposition is an established and a part of the democratic system. The opposition is very much part and parcel of the parliamentary democratic system. In a democracy, the people are sovereign. When the sovereign people vote for the opposition, how can those elected representatives be considered illegitimate? How can they be delegitimized? This is not the politics of democracy. This is authoritarian populism. This is strongman politics. It's not enough to win, you want total domination. This year the voters have cut you to size and in fact voted for the opposition. There's a democracy deficit when the free press is crushed. As I mentioned earlier, India ranks 159 out of 180 in annual World Press Freedom Index released by Reporters Without Borders. India's press freedom has fallen 19 places since the BJP-led dispensation came to power in 2014. In para 26, the Honorable President of India said in her address that in the era of communication revolution, disruptive forces are conspiring to weaken democracy. But who is weakening democracy in the media, sir? The democracy is being weakened by an overbearing government which is guiding, manipulating, terrorizing, muzzling, threatening journalists. I was shocked to see that journalists are not allowed, accredited senior journalists today, are not allowed in the precincts of parliament. This is truly shocking for a parliamentary democracy. There is a democracy deficit when hate speech is normalized. When hate speech against religious communities is normalized and unacceptable, and those who are responsible for this hate speech get state protection. 75% of hate speech events come from states ruled by the BJP, according to the India Hate Lab. There is a democracy deficit when lynch mobs are not given exemplary punishment. Does the government care that three men died in a horrific case of mob lynching in Chhattisgarh earlier this month? There have been many such crimes. They've gone unnoticed. A report by India Spend reveals that 97% of all attacks centered on cattle-related issues between 2010 and 2017. 97% cases were reported in the last 3 years. 61 out of a total 63 such cases are registered after the creation of the cow protection squad and beef trade restrictions, showing that it is under BJP dispensation. It is under BJP dispensation that these attacks have increased. There is a democracy deficit when a civil war has raged for over a year in a state, and that state's name cannot be mentioned by the Honorable President in her address, and the Prime Minister does not even visit once to Manipur, where over 70,000 are homeless and 200 have died. There is a democracy deficit when those in power are not accountable. There's little accountability to those in power, neither to students, nor to rail victims, nor to youth promised floors of jobs, nor to women who are victims of crime. There have been 244 consequential train accidents between 2017 and 2022. Does the government care? The percentage of tickets the BJP was proudly proclaiming that it's brought in the Women's Reservation Bill. But the percentage of tickets given to women by the BJP this time